Hello everybody and welcome back to my channel. So today's video is outside of my normal schedule. I decided to put out two videos this week because my sister actually brought this case to my attention and I knew that I had to get her story out there as soon as I possibly could. I already had a video scheduled for this week, as you saw on Tuesday, but I still wanted to get this out as soon as possible, so here I am. I am making another video for this week. This is a very recent case, but we actually do have a lot of information, and we pretty much know exactly who is responsible. However, given today's climate, I still feel that her case is so important to talk about, and we cannot let her case get lost in the news cycle. We need to say her name, Alawatoan, and make her case be remembered. With that being said, let's just get right into today's video. Alawatoan Salah, who also went by Toyin, was born on August 27th, 2000 in Florida. She was described as a leader. She was very outspoken, courageous, resilient, and strong, yet caring, spiritual, and loving. She knew what she needed to fight for, and she fought for it with everything she had. A friend had said that she was so incredibly motivated and encouraged those around her to use their voices for good. She was absolutely loved by those around her. She was a Black Lives Matter activist who was going out there and protesting as one of the most prominent voices in the Tallahassee rally.
It's not that all lives don't matter, but right now, our lives matter. Black lives matter.
Yes.
Black trans lives matter.
Yes.
Trans lives matter.
Yes.
Because guess what? We all minorities, but right now, like, let's focus on the person who got killed. Tony McDay was a Black trans man. Okay?
Amen.
We're not doing this. We're doing this for him. We're doing this for our brothers and our sisters who got shot, but we're doing this for every Black person. Because at the end of the day, I cannot take my fucking skin color off. I cannot mask this shit, okay? Everywhere I fucking go, I'm profiled whether I like it or not.
That ain't right.
Like, I'm looked at whether I like it or not.
That ain't right.
First of all, I want white people to realize their fucking privilege.
Yes, ma'am.
No one can look at you and tell anything about you unless you give them that information. Wherever the fuck I go, I'm profiled. Mm-hmm. Look at my hair, look at my skin, bruh.
We love it.
I can't take this shit off, so guess what? I'ma die about it.
Yeah,
I'ma die about my fucking skin. You cannot take my fucking Blackness away from me. My Blackness is not for your consumption. It's not. It's not. Okay? It's not. And y'all need to listen. It's like I said, it's okay to be angry. Use wisdom. Don't move stupidly and get yourself hurt.
Now, on June 6th, 2020 of this year, shortly before she went missing, Toyin had tweeted about being sexually assaulted by a man after he had offered to give her a ride to give her somewhere to sleep because she had been staying at the nearby church due to unjust living conditions, which we will get into. She had a series of disturbing tweets that outlined the sexual assault, and I will read them for you right now. I was in Tallahassee, Florida by a Black man this morning at 5:30 on Richview and Park Avenue. The man offered to give me a ride to find some place to sleep and recollect my belongings from a church I refuged to a couple days back to escape unjust living conditions. He came disguised as a man of God and ended up picking me up from nearby Saxton Street. I entered his truck only because I don't carry anything to defend myself, not even a phone, which is currently at the church, and I have poor vision. I trusted the Holy Spirit to keep me safe. When we arrived at his house, he offered me a shower, and I thanked him, and I showered, and he gave me a change of clothes. He exposed himself to me, peeping with the bathroom open, obviously knowing I was out of it. I told him about a sexual assault situation that happened to me in March, involving Ivan, a 32-year-old Ghanaian man who currently schools at FAMU and lives at 211 Jakes in Patterson. I am currently 19 years old, who tried to force me to give him oral sex and then continued to harass me through text and knocking at my door for days. Going back to the situation that happened to me this morning, I did not fall asleep. He then asked me if I wanted a massage. At this moment, his roommate, who was in the house, was asleep. I was lying on my stomach trying to calm myself down from severe PTSD. He started touching my back and rubbing my body, using my body until he climaxed and then went to sleep. Before I realized what happened to me, I looked over and his clothes were completely off. Once I saw he was asleep, I escaped the house and started walking from Richview Road to anywhere else. All of my belongings, my phone, my clothes, shoes, are all assumably at church, where I've been trying to track since I sought spiritual guidance and refuge. I will not be silent. Literally wearing this man's clothes right now, DNA all over me, because I couldn't locate his house the moment I called police because I couldn't see. We will get more into these tweets in just a minute, but just to give you a clear timeline, this was posted on June 6th. This was the same day that she attended the Black Lives Matter protest, where she was protesting the murders of Tony McCade, who is from Tallahassee, and George Floyd, and demanding justice for the black lives that had been lost. I also want to mention that some sources say the church that she was staying at had been the Wesley Impact Church, just to be more specific. So this is where the timeline does get a little bit confusing, so just hang in there with me. So apparently by June 8th, according to the Kearney Center, Toyin went to their homeless shelter at around 9:30 p.m. that night. Now, I will note that according to friends, Toyin was not homeless. She was just living at these different places because she was escaping abuse at the hands of her family, saying that she had been repeatedly sexually abused by her family, so she was just trying to find somewhere to stay to escape from that. Now, the facility is closed due to the coronavirus, but they do shelter individuals at other places. So because of this, she was given the phone number of a case manager who she could reach out to, who was supposed to help her seek emergency shelter. After visiting the Kearney Center, Toyin called an Uber and left. The Kearney Center said that it appeared as if she had not ended up reaching out to the case manager. Others had reached out to the shelter to see if she was there, but obviously they couldn't tell them that information due to confidentiality laws. Then Toyin was seen on surveillance video at the Tallahassee ice cream shop Big Easy Snowballs on June 10th. In many articles that I had read, it didn't mention this before, so I believe that this is a very recent discovery, because by June 9th, so the day before, word has started to spread about Toyin going missing, and the Tallahassee Police Department sent out a tweet stating that the Tallahassee PD Special Victims Unit was requesting information on the location of Toyin Salah. They reported that she was last seen on June 6, 2020, in the area of Orange Avenue and Wanish Way in Tallahassee. Then on June 13th, police had tweeted about another woman who had gone missing in the same area. 75-year-old Victoria Sims was a retired state worker and an AARP volunteer in Tallahassee for over 10 years. She was described as being a kind, gentle soul who always had something to add to the tough conversations. She wasn't afraid to ask our lawmakers the tough questions, and she too fought for what she believed in and was a volunteer. Now, one of Victoria's neighbors came by her apartment to check up on her, and they saw that her apartment door had been open. When police arrived, they saw that her apartment was absolutely torn apart. Someone had very clearly broke in and just ransacked her apartment. Her apartment is also just 1 mile away from where Toyin had been sexually assaulted on June 6th. Now, it wasn't long before police started their investigation that led them exactly to what happened to not only Victoria, but to Toyin as well. Police were able to track Victoria's phone using the GPS to the home of a 49-year-old man named Aaron Glee. The house was an old rundown house with a tarp and trash in the yard pretty much everywhere. When they got there, they found Victoria's white Toyota sedan stuck in the mud. It appeared as if the person was trying to drive north through the mud but was unable to. There was a white sheet covering the rear end of the car, which concealed the license plate. The license plate was also bent upwards to try and make it impossible to read. Police officers walked up to the door and knocked, but no one answered, but they knew that Victoria's phone was at the home, and they thought that she could be in danger, so they broke in. Upon entering, they found Victoria's body in a bedroom, covered in a white blanket that was absolutely soaked in blood. Her body was found with her wrists and ankles bound behind her back. The house smelled like cigarettes, as if someone had just recently smoked in the house. Police searched throughout the home but didn't find anyone else there. Shortly after, another officer with a police dog started heading into the thick backwoods behind Aaron Glee's rented home. This was when they discovered the body of 19-year-old Alawatoan Salah. She was covered in leaves and was about 200 feet north of the house. As they were at the home, police then heard a cell phone ringing from the trash can outside. They thought that maybe this belonged to a suspect who was maybe hiding inside the trash can, so they decided to lift the lid and look inside. In the trash can, they found a black cell phone with a black case on it, along with Victoria Sims' Florida driver's license. As they continued searching the area, they actually found a bullet casing of an unknown caliber embedded in the driveway of the home. They found a credit card on a barbecue grill and a $10 bill on the path leading from Victoria's car to Toyin's body in the woods. Neighbors noticed that police were at Aaron's home, so they came out to speak with them. They said that they had been in touch with Aaron's cousin, who had called Aaron to ask him why so many cops were at his home. Aaron, of course, told his cousin that there was nothing going on and mentioned that he had actually gotten a one-way bus ticket from Tallahassee to West Palm Beach. This is where he apparently had different family members living. He used cash to get this one-way ticket, but he did not end up making it all the way to West Palm Beach. He only made it as far as Orlando because police officers were waiting for him after police from Tallahassee had contacted them to be on the lookout for him. Officers detained him, and while doing so, they noticed that he had something that looked like a bloodstain still on his pants. At this point, he was charged with felony murder and kidnapping. So now let's talk a little bit about this man, Aaron Glee. We don't know a lot about him as a person. Neighbors even said that they barely knew him and said that he didn't seem like he had a car because he was often seen walking up and down the road. We don't know much else, but what we do know is that he did have a very recent history of battery and assault. So on May 28th, police were called to a bus stop on Governor Square Boulevard near Mangolia Drive, which is a popular place for homeless people to just kind of hang out. 911 was called to the area with a report saying that a woman had asked for help after she had been assaulted. When police got there, Aaron was gone. However, there was another witness there who said that he saw Aaron hitting another man who was still on scene. It was very clear to police officers right away that this man had in fact been punched in the face and in the head. Police found Aaron walking a few blocks down the road and detained him. They brought him back so that the man could ID him, and this man said that he was 100% positive that it was Aaron who was in fact the man who had assaulted him. But what police also noticed was that there weren't any real signs on Aaron's hands that could indicate that he punched anyone. Now, at this point, police were avoiding taking in suspects for less serious crimes to avoid overcrowding at prisons because of the pandemic. So instead of taking him into custody, they issued him a notice to appear in court for a misdemeanor battery charge, and the court date was set for July 7th. However, before he made it to his court day, he once again would be charged with another count of battery. On May 29th, the next day, a police officer was stopped at a stoplight at Blairstone Road and K Avenue when he allegedly saw Aaron Glee kicking a woman in the stomach. This woman, who is not identified but who we know is not Victoria or Toyin, told police that her and Aaron had been drinking together and they were walking down the sidewalk when he started making sexual advances. She turned him down, so he became extremely angry. So he threw her down to the sidewalk and began kicking her in the stomach. When police brought Aaron in, he said that he knew this woman because she was homeless, and he said that he would often, you know, help the homeless out and buy them food and beverages. He said that he had bought this woman food and drink in the past. He said that on this day, the woman had offered to give him sexual favors. So that prompted him to buy two bottles of alcohol, which they drank together. However, after a while, she had actually changed her mind and said that she no longer wanted to do this sexual favor for him. He got upset and demanded that she pay him back the $60 that he paid for the liquor. He said that he did not kick her or hurt her, and that the injuries that she had were not from him. So he was in police custody for felony charges for aggravated assault. However, the staff at the Leon County Detention Center did not conduct an interview with him to determine if he could be released because they deemed him a danger to the pretrial release staff. However, the pretrial form that they needed to fill out was incomplete. The document had indicated that he did not have any psychological problems, but other sources said that he did have a psychological disorder. They said that he had never been involved with police in terms of a psychological disorder, so that is why they did not identify one on the form. It had also said incomplete on the form, where a numerical score should be listed that was supposed to indicate the possibility of flight or future crimes. So because of this, even though he was considered dangerous, it was never documented fully. So at his first court appearance on May 31st, he pled not guilty, and County Judge Robert Plains set his bail at $2,500. He posted bail paying 10% and was released on June 1st. So yes, even though police were investigating these crimes and they were taking them seriously, it was negligence that caused him to be able to leave jail early when he never should have been able to leave. Now, at this point, you're probably wondering if Aaron Glee could possibly be the same man who had sexually assaulted Toyin before she was killed. Police had said that he actually didn't match the description of the man who was thought to have been responsible. And she had actually quote tweeted her original tweet and said, mid-40s, lives in a gray painted duplex apartment style house, drives a white clean Silverado Chevrolet truck. So given this information, it does not seem that the two descriptions match. And it seems like there is a man who is still out there who is a sexual predator, just walking free and doing whatever he pleases. Either way, after being released on bail, on a very shockingly low bail given how serious his crime was and how violent he had been in the previous 2 days, two women lost their lives. An absolutely beautiful 19-year-old young woman who just wanted to seek justice for those who had lost their lives. She died fighting for others who met the same fate as her. And a 75-year-old woman who had a beautiful soul and just wanted to help her community, who was not known to have a mean bone in her body. Both of these women had their lives ripped away from them in the most horrific manner. So now let's go back to where we left off after these two women's bodies were found. So after Aaron Glee was taken into police custody, he actually waived his right to remain silent and gave a complete account of what happened to the police officers of what he had done to these women. He sat down to police and confessed everything that he had done in the most detailed and gruesome manner possible. So Aaron had met Toyin at a bus stop on June 6th. She told him that she did not have a permanent place to stay, so he invited her to stay at his home. So he had called Victoria to see if she could come pick the two of them up. Victoria had often cooked meals for him and given ride to him and others in the community. She didn't ask for anything in return. She was just a kind-hearted woman who went out of her way to help him and so many others. So, of course, she came and picked the two of them up. At this point, they got to his home. And this is when he held Toyin captive for 3 to 5 days. He had sexually abused her and then killed her in his home. He said that he knew that he would be arrested if he let Toyin leave, so he thought that this was the only option to kill her because of how much he had sexually abused her. Which I do want to say that this account doesn't completely match up with the timeline, which is why I said it gets a little bit confusing, because she was seen apparently on June 10th. So I don't know if he meant that he met her on June 6th and then maybe saw her a few days later. And that's when, you know, Victoria came and picked them up and, you know, she brought them home. I'm not exactly sure, but either way, that's pretty much what happened to her. She was held captive, sexually assaulted several times, and then killed for absolutely no reason. After this, he went to Victoria's apartment. He completely ransacked the place. He stole her car and then kidnapped her. As we know, her car was found stuck in the mud at his house. and their bodies would later be found on the property, and then everything else that we just discussed. As of right now, Aaron Glee is being held in police custody with 2 counts of kidnapping, 2 counts of murder, including 1 count of second-degree murder and premeditated murder, and 1 count of sexual assault, though the grand jury is considering upping his charges to first-degree murder. He appeared in court and is being held right now without bond. And that is where the case is at right now. Obviously, this is a very ongoing and recent case. It happened less than a month ago. Make sure to follow my Twitter so I can share with you the most up-to-date information as it comes out, rather than me waiting to, you know, gather enough information to make a video or another post here on YouTube. At the end of the day, 2 beautiful lives are lost. As if the world isn't facing enough injustices right now. Yet another young, beautiful, Black life was lost for absolutely no reason at all. And I am just hoping and praying that someday soon that all of this just stops, but I know that that day is very, very far away. So now I'm going to go ahead and talk about everything that you can do to help so that we can actually try and make a difference. First, let's talk about Justice for Black Girls. Justice for Black Girls is an organization that has set up an Alawatoyan Salo Freedom Fighters Fund. They write, "Alawatoyan was a freedom fighter. We will continue to fight in her honor of her legacy. She did not ask to be a martyr for justice. May her death shake up the systems on behalf of Black girls everywhere who exist at the intersection of racial injustice and gender-based violence." This fund is designed to provide monetary relief for Black girl activists like Toyin who are on the front lines. This fund allows Black girls to request grants up to $750 for overnight housing, rent relief, food, or other life-sustaining supports. We know that Toyin was fighting for protection of everyone else, but couldn't find that protection for herself. The website allows Black girl activists who are under 25 years old living in the US to apply for relief. Their application is closed for now, as far as I have last seen. That might have changed by the time this video goes up, but I saw that they are reopening sometime in July. Make sure to check out their website if you want to donate, or if you yourself believe that you can qualify for this grant and you are in need of help. That all being said, Toyin's death has sparked yet another conversation about the state of Black lives in our country. Some have pointed out that women and members of the LGBTQ community are often left out of the conversation and aren't given as much attention as men. The names of other Black women who have been killed by police, such as Priscilla Slater and Pamela Turner, are largely unfamiliar to the greater public. While at the same time, the hashtag SayHerName movement that has been started to help support women whose lives are at risk has morphed into hashtag say his name online and in protests. Not only do we need to fight for Black lives, but we need to fight for all Black lives. Women of color are not only fighting against racism, but they fight sexism as well. Women with darker skin, kinkier hair, face even deeper discrimination. There is an unspoken pressure to look a certain way, to speak a certain way, act a certain way. Women of color have expressed their frustration that they are deemed as traitors when they want to speak out against the violence that, you know, they face at the hands of men of all races, including men of color. A call has been made for Black men to come to terms with violence against women and for Black women to stop seeking protection from men in general. We need to have a discussion on how Black lives are being treated in this country, and we are, and there are so many people out there who are trying to make a difference, just like Alawatoyan was. We do need to have that discussion, but we also need to discuss how women, especially women of color, are being treated at the same time. They can't just continue to be ignored. They can't be left out of the conversation like they so often are. The organization I listed above is a great place to learn more about how you can help Black women and girls, and why it is so important to keep lifting up our Black queens to continue fighting against oppression. We all should be involved in the conversation, no matter who you are, what you look like, what you identify as. We can all agree that these are important conversations to have, even if you're not being directly affected by them. I'm not being directly affected by them. I am not a woman of color. But we cannot let this issue just be forgotten, and we need to get as many voices as possible contributing to the conversation. We need to not let this get lost in the news cycle as soon as the news gets bored of talking about it and find something else to talk about. We have to remember women of color. We have to remember all Black lives. We need to remember Alawatoan Salah. So that is all I have for today's case. At the end of the day, we have lost yet another young, beautiful soul who had her entire life ahead of her and was going to go on to do amazing things. She was a firecracker. She was not going to let anyone stop her. She knew what she believed in, and she knew how she was going to make people listen. This young woman had lived a life of being sexually abused at every turn, before being sexually abused yet again, before she was murdered. We cannot let her story go silent, and we have to continue the fight. Thank you so much for listening to Alawatoyan's story, and be sure to check out the links below to find out what you can do to help. And again, make sure to head over to my Twitter to keep up to date with any further information that comes out about her case and pretty much all other cases that I've covered here on my channel. So that is where I'm going to end today's video. If you liked today's video, please make sure to leave this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. I put out new true crime and mystery videos every single week. Don't forget to check out my social media links below. And if you have absolutely any case suggestions, please make sure to send them over to my email at rachelshannoncases@gmail.com. With that, I hope you guys have a great week, and I hope to see you next time. Bye!